Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the USA Dance Annual General Meeting. We are starting, obviously, at this time, and we are just going to proceed into the meeting. Thank you for attending, and I did want to just state up front that we apologize for the technical difficulties we had about 6 weeks ago. And obviously it took us some time. We were searching for various tools and looking at tools that would work, and it took us a while to identify which ones would work for this presentation. So I appreciate your patience, and let's move on with the meeting. So, all right, the schedule today is that I'm calling the meeting to order. We are then going to have, as you see in the schedule, a number of people presenting this afternoon. And again, this meeting, this presentation will be posted later on for everyone to review, but you can see the schedule in front of you. And we will be covering the various areas within the organization at today's meeting. Just so everybody's aware of who is currently on your board of directors, there's myself as president, Greg Warner as senior VP, Spencer Chang as treasurer, and we have Forenza Todaro as secretary. Social VP is Leland Whitney. Dance board VP is Giacomo Staccaglia. Professional VP, Melissa Dexter. And then we have our dance board delegates, Sina Breyer, Roger Greenewalt, Michael Murphy, and Damian Pataluna. And then we have directors Don Davenport, Herb McGurk, and Ross Pierce. Greg, would you please go over the 2019 AGM review?
Certainly. Thank you, Gary. This is Greg Warner speaking. rather than writing detailed minutes of these annual general meetings, since they are all posted on Social Link for people to review, we won't write lengthy minutes, but just to review again what was discussed last year, you can see that on this slide. Some of the issues we talked about last year will again be talked about this year, but I don't know that we need to say anything more about last year's meeting, Gary.
All right, thank you, Greg. Then I'll proceed with the first section of the presentation. And I'm going to cover the vision we have for the organization. As all of you, I'm sure, aware, the mission of our organization is to improve the quality and quantity of dance in the United States. And that mission we've been following for the last few years. It was expanded a few years ago. And that is the direction we're heading. And for those of you, you may recall from previous AGMs that our vision really is to transform lives through dance. And so that is where we are from a vision perspective. But from an organizational perspective, given our purpose, we are really trying to restructure the organization and to grow the organization. And so here are some of the things that we have been working on and continue to work on over the past year and these upcoming years as well. So we really need to focus on rebuilding our community, and that means, you know, attracting and integrating members into our community. And when I say community, I mean all the various constituents we have. But clearly, we have our social membership, we have our dance board athletes, and we have our professional community, and we need to integrate those communities together and work together. And so we are focusing and working on doing that, and I'll be talking about that a little bit more in a few minutes. But one portion of those communities, part of those, actually a couple of those communities, that are the community program driven growth that we're pursuing with our collegiate programs. There are a number of collegiate programs across the country in various schools, not necessarily affiliated to any particular organization, but we have been working on and expanding the exposure that USA Dance has to these programs via the National Collegiate Championships, which we've been running for the past few years. and we were working on that, on expanding that program and visibility in USA Dance and attracting those members to our organization. More on that later. And we're also focused on inorganic growth. And so from that perspective and also the expansion of our scope, which I alluded to earlier, is we're looking at other dance forms. And beyond the ballroom dance that we traditionally have been working on and involved with as an organization historically. And we are looking at that as an opportunity for growth. I mean, as you may have be aware, may have observed, we have each dance form tends to operate in cycles. Right now, we're in a down cycle in the in form of dance, the ballroom dance, not only in the United States but across the world, where other forms of dance are expanding. And so, from that perspective, it makes sense that we look at other forms of dance and expand our scope to that in order to stabilize the organization and our membership. And then, as many of you may be aware, that the Olympic Committee has been going through some turmoil in recent years, and also this year with respect to the postponement of the Olympic Games, it's been additional stress on the organization. We continue to try to be aligned with that, with the Olympic organization, the goals, ideals, and structure, and are working towards, as those changes are coming out, which they've been changing their bylaws recently, we are moving to comply with those changes as they come about. This year, we've been working on a number of items, and specifically, we have been working on restructuring our organization and in a variety of ways. And so from a business perspective, we've been transitioning to be more aligned with the recommendations from the Olympic Committee, which involves reducing the size of our governing council, which we have now changed the name of that to the Board of Directors to again align with recommended terminology that the Olympic Committee uses. So we will be changing, if you haven't seen it yet, you will be seeing that in all our documents, we're changing it to Board of Directors moving forward. We're also moving functional responsibilities to our committees. Historically, many of the responsibilities have been borne by the board of directors, and you know, that's a limited number of individuals. And so as we move and shrink the size of the board of directors, we also need to consider that we as the board don't have all the skill sets that are needed to run the entire corporation on a national level. And so we need people that are skilled in various aspects of management and various technical areas and have them really be able to manage certain functions. And an example of those might be the new marketing committee, for instance, that we've established, which we can talk about in a few minutes. But those types of functions are being moved to committees, of course, with various boundaries set, and so that they are operating within those fiscal boundaries and the scope boundaries of the responsibilities of those particular committees. We have worked hard to reduce cost expenditures over the last few years and continue to do so. You know, this past year, we've eliminated the face-to-face meeting requirements, so there will not be one this year for the board of directors. That it reduces costs to the organization. That was in the bylaws and had to be removed. The transition from an employee-based organization where we had a number of employees, you know, in the organization or contractors, to association management is also a cost reduction move. We anticipate the costs to be substantially less than the costs of engaging employees and or contractors. And we will as we move forward through the course of this year, see how those numbers play out. But it looks like we will be having a substantial reduction in fees and costs this year as a result of that move. Associated with that move is that we've been able to reduce our insurance costs. The insurance, for instance, we had to have employee liability insurance. We don't need that anymore. We moved our insurance, our headquarters of the organization from Florida to New Jersey. That substantially reduced our costs because the cost for insurance headquarters in New Jersey is substantially less than that in Florida. So our insurance costs have gone down as well. We've been transitioning to contracting our nationals out, our national championships, that being the our nationals that we had to postpone this year, to other organizers, outside organizers, with, of course, oversight from the national board. That reduces, again, a significant reduction of costs coming in next year and this year as well, since those costs are going to be borne by the organizers, so for running the events. And so from that perspective, that is also putting our organization on a better fiscal footing than it has been in past years. And then we've also reduced the athlete travel stipend. That reduction will again help us with our cost management. In process, we have a number of activities that are ongoing. From an inorganic growth perspective, we're looking at a number of different areas. I'm sure people have been aware of the Braken affiliation that we're working with right now. Special Olympics, we have been working and trying to work with the Special Olympics across the United States in all 50 states, and trying to establish dance sport in the United States, since it is becoming a World Special Olympics event. So that is in an effort that will be discussed later. Paired dance sport, we're working with a number of organizations on that as well. And then of course, gender neutral, we're expanding that, and that's in the dance sport arena. We are improving our social media communications. We established a marketing communications committee. Part of that is social media. We have an individual targeted and focused on social media communications. We have four other individuals working on a marketing plan right now for the organization. Those individuals who are volunteers all of these individuals are volunteers, but those who have volunteered have extensive experience in marketing and communications on the order of 15 to 30 years experience each. This is a very good news for us, and we're looking forward to the plan that they're developing and will be coming or bringing to us here in the next few weeks, and then beginning implementing that plan. From a business process perspective, we've introduced Social Link. That still needs to gain more traction and work. We need to continue to work on building that and using that as a mechanism to build the community among our membership. Similarly with our websites, we've established the websites using our Your Membership tool, which is what supports the national website, but we're supporting the chapter websites through that tool, and continue to move chapters and expand the capabilities for chapters on that tool. We've established online sanctioning forms for our competitions so that our organizers can register online now instead of doing it via paper. And there's an automated proficiency point system that's in development and that's being worked on, and we hope to be rolling that out in the next few months. However, we're still facing a number of significant challenges as an organization, and those challenges include decline in membership, both in the social and dance sports side of the organization. We have a number of chapters that are at risk because of their small size. And that we have been seeing over the past few years results in very limited number of volunteers, which can run the chapter. And over time, when those volunteers can no longer want to take on or can take on those responsibilities, those chapters close down. So we really need to build up the membership in each chapter. And by doing so, that will build the community. We have financial risks. We have reduced revenue. And obviously, as time goes on, you have increased costs due to cost of living increases. So there's financial risks we've been mitigating, as I mentioned earlier, through cost reductions. We have limited communication between our national and local levels. And that's a problem. We recognize it's a problem, and we have not addressed that as well as we could have over the past a couple of years. And so now that we have finally found volunteers that want to work, that are willing to work and with us and develop communication plans and help us with these communications, we expect that to change over the course of the next, couple of months. And then lack of community within and across the membership, and that has to do with how we integrate within our various constituencies and groups. And we really need to work on how we can do that. We've obviously taken steps in that direction. The examples would be the flash mob activity, for example, that was initiated a few years ago by the professional division, but we really need to look at other mechanisms, and of course we have with the dance boards having the athletes perform at chapters, for example, in order to receive their stipends. We need to have other mechanisms to help build those bridges. So we continue to need our member commitment and support. And in order to build the organization and to grow and to establish the relationships between all of us and understand what our various needs are and work together to achieve and build an organization that continues to be lasting and continues to help us do whatever we like to do in dance over the course of the next few years. So I want to thank you for doing that, and I'm going to pass this on in a moment to Greg Warner. But one last thing I should mention is that we've had significant challenges with COVID-19. We certainly have significant social distancing issues across the country, and those continue today. That has significant membership impact over the first 6 months of the year, and of course it impacts on events as well. As many of you know, chapter events have pretty much been canceled in every state, in every chapter, as well as the competitions across the United States. So we need to continue to follow our CDC guidelines and our local and state authorities in order to mitigate this particular issue. And certainly we don't want to have significant illnesses within any of our chapters or among our membership. So we can need to continue to follow those. Greg, would you like to move on?
Yes, thanks, Gary. I forgot to unmute. Right. Gary mentioned several significant changes that are going on, and often with significant changes come significant challenges. And I can think of few significant changes and challenges that we as an organization can face then transitioning away from Mary and her history of this organization over the past 20 years. But nonetheless, we decided to make that decision now at a time when Mary could assist with that transition. And of course, she's been of great assistance. An association management company can provide a lot of features to an organization that is run primarily by volunteers like USA Dance has done. So after we went through an RFP process, we selected Tally Management to assist us with this. What an associate management company can do is virtually anything an organization wants them to do. And there are two approaches to that. One's a fixed method and one's an hourly method. We have selected the hourly method, which I'll talk a little bit more in the next budget or next bullet point. But what we are focusing on during these first few months of transition is administrative activities and services, and that's primarily member services, renewing members, signing up new members, responding to their questions, and those kinds of things. And of course, Tally doesn't have the history or the information on to respond to many of those questions, but they're relying on us on the board to help them make those, and they will create libraries so that they can ask to answer those questions the next time they're asked. The other significant benefit of having a company like this is that when we change over officers in this volunteer organization, they have some history for us, and that's especially important, I think, in the financial services. USA Dance has not always been blessed with having a CPA like we now have with Spencer Chang to help us with our financial activities, but Tally has several CPAs on, and they will continue to be there, so they can provide the history and the support as the treasurer changes over when there are elections. That's really important for us. The other thing that they're really helping us with is documenting our procedures and making sure that we're developing good internal controls, which are important to a board for their fiduciary responsibility, but also for our external auditors when they do our audits. I mentioned, and Gary alluded to the expense associated with this, and this question has been asked, and I think it's an important one to answer as specifically as we can. Obviously, the contract we have with Tally is confidential, but suffice us to say that last year we had approximately $120,000 of salary employee expense, and by employee, I mean both our employees, the two employees that we had, and our contractor. Our budget for Tally management this year is less than 50% of that expense that we paid last year. Now, that's a variable expense, and that was one of the attractivenesses of moving with Tally. Again, we are paying them at an hourly rate, and they provide us reports on how they're spending time so we can understand where our costs are. But we moved that from a fixed expense to a variable expense, and that helps us much more with our budgeting. It provides flexibility for our budgeting processes. The other thing that Tally has to offer, they're a full service management company. So as we have needs for outside expertise, Tally will be able to respond to us through an RFP, probably a lot cheaper than other organizations because they have come to know a lot about USA Dance, better understands our needs, our strengths, and our weaknesses, and can focus their RFP better to service. I think it's also interesting to note that one of the principals for Tally went so far as to become a member of USA Dance so that he could better understand USA Dance, but also he and his wife wanted to start dancing. And so we did gain one new member with that transition. Go ahead to the next slide, Gary, please. Gary, could I have the next slide, please? Thank you. Gary mentioned the Special Olympics, and we just received word a couple days ago that it has been announced that in August of 2021, there will be the first Special Olympic World Championship in dance sport in Graz, Austria. And that's very exciting for this group of athletes. And to give you a little background and perspective, Special Olympics North America contacted USA Dance and wanting to partner with us since we have this network of chapters out there that could assist with providing opportunities for Special Olympic athletes. It is a little bit challenging, however, in that each state has its own Special Olympic nonprofit organization. Each state decides how they will spend their money what sports they decide to support, because no Special Olympic athlete has any expense associated with competition. That includes traveling expense, coaching expense, or uniform. We have started talking with chapters that we knew have Special Olympic kind of programs in the states, and some states are supportive and other states are not supportive. We've reached out to other states that have an interest but need to learn more about it. And so a lot of those communications were occurring before COVID. And so it's been temporarily put on hold, but I think with this new announcement, we need to go back and rejuvenate the interest in this, because this is a great opportunity for these athletes, and we hope to be able to support them and move them forward. I think we can go to the next slide, Gary. The last kind of major project I've been working on is with Paradansport. There was a Paralympian who contacted the United States Olympic and Paralympic Committee asking how she could go about getting Paralympic dance sport, wheelchair dancing, into the Paralympics. And the USOPC referred her to USA Dance. And so we have begun working with her and have identified other volunteers who are working with us towards that goal of qualifying para dance sport for the Paralympics. This group has I put together a five-year plan that will cover many of the issues that you see under challenges. But I'd like just to let you know that this group, we have a former Paralympian who kind of was the start of this. We have Miss New Jersey Wheelchair involved. We have two judges who are certified to judge para dancing, and we have several others who have worked with people in wheelchairs and in dancing. And I would just also note at this time, if you have any interest in working with us, we'd be more than happy to engage you in this wonderful journey that we're on to become a Paralympic sport. Well, some of the challenges that we're facing is just identifying and organizing who all the dancers are and bringing those folks together so that we can use their expertise and experiences as we move forward. The most significant thing that is occurring right now is we have a group that's developing a syllabus for this, and this is the major first step. This syllabus will include competitive paradancing. It will include social paradance sport. We're also looking at standing and seated, and then seated and seated partnerships. So there'll be standard and Latin and showcase and maybe a few others. So it'll be a lot of work, but it'll be very rewarding once they get to the end of this. Another very interesting aspect of this sport is there needs to be certified classifiers. And a certified classifier is a medical professional who evaluates these athletes and then categorizes them into one of two categories so that the competition level is fairly equal. And this categorization is based on the person's injury or disability, if you will, but helps them that they're competing on a fairly equal playing field. And then the last kind of major issue that we'll have to undertake is just identifying the judges, training them and certifying them. During this journey, we will be doing showcases at USA Dance events. We had a showcase scheduled for the national championships in Utah in April, but of course, with the cancellation, that fell through. But we hope to have more of those. We were able to get a grant to support those athletes had they been able to go to Utah, and we hope we can get grants to support them when we go to other ones. As I said, if you have any interest in the para dance sport or even Special Olympics, please let me know. The more people we have working on this, the more successful we will be. And with that, it's my privilege to introduce Spencer Chang, our treasurer for USA Dance.
Thank you, Greg, for your presentation. Good afternoon and good morning for West Coast members. Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Spencer Chan. It's my honor and privilege to serve as treasurer for USA Dance. Today, I would like to present the 2019 financial and 2020 budget on a cash basis. The financials presented to you today may differ from the 2019 financial from our outside auditor, given that our presentation is for the cash basis rather than accrual basis. Once the auditor report is complete, it will be posted on our website. In addition, the 2019 financial here does not include the chapter's financial. Before I present the financial, I would like to explain cash basis versus accrual basis for our entity. The majority of our financial items are deferred revenues, receivables, and prepaid expenses per accrual basis. The revenue recognition will be allocated based on the time of the fund received, such as a membership due receipt. We recognize the income when we receive for fund per cash basis. In addition, prepaid expenses are recorded for expenses disbursed, but benefit for payment can be carried into the next accounting period. We record expenses that expend on a cash basis. Receivable are recorded as income per accrual basis, but not in cash basis, because we have not received the fund. This first slide we're gonna present to you is the total assets for 2019. And total assets about 400,000, which is primarily comprised of cash in bank, about 317,000, represents 79%. And in addition, accounts receivable, about 52,000, represents 13%. And our current assets, prepaid expenses, 32,000, 8% carry over from prior years. I think auditor will make adjustment for that number. And I would like to first focus on cash in bank, which is tangible and can be utilized. And the majority other receivable are from Max Support, which is Manhattan Amateur Competition. One of the questions asked by members about the Max expenses, so I covered that briefly here. This include about 48,000 for 2018 and 42,000 for 2019. So total receivable increased from almost 40,000 leading to the new max amount of about 90,000 on the book. As we move to next slide, Gary, next slide. Next slide, please, Gary. Next slide, Gary. Next slide. Gary, are you there?
Yeah, it's just not moving. Give me one.
Okay. All right.
There we go.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
All right. As we move to the next slide, you will see the breakout for total assets for this year, 2020. At the time we present the slide, is end of April 30. Obviously, we have most the current one, which is end of June. But still, primary cash in bank about 319,000, that's 72%. Accounts receivable increased up to 91,000, that majority from the Max Support, and other current assets, prepaid expenses, carry over from prior year 32,000, which represents 11%, which that number could be adjusted down or up by external auditor. On the next slide, the next slide, we're gonna move to 2019 total income. Gary, next slide.
I'm trying.
Okay, thank you so much. Okay. All right, it's there. A little big pie chart. On the next slide, we'll move to 2019 total income. Total income we see is about approximately 620,000. Where majority is from membership due, which is 357,000. That represents 68%. And the other pieces of total income are admissions, 129,000, 21%. Contribution, 71,000. 11%, and the other 63,000, about 10%. However, due to COVID-19, we expect our total income to decrease for the 2020. All right, please move to the next slide. The next slide is our 2019 expenses based on cash basis. The total expenses for our prior year total, 2019, about 693,000, which include chapter support, 57,000, that include Max Support, 8%. The college and network and championship, about 123,000, about 18%. The National Dance Support Championship, 177,000, represents 26%. The membership, the other membership support, 110,000, 16%. Athlete travel, only 33,000, about 5%. The general administrative expenses that include our payroll, as in the mainstream by Gray, about 192,000, 20%, and the other expenses only 1,200 below 1%. Gray mentioned about we engage a management company to replace the current labor cost, which was including that general administrative expenses, and expect to a decrease in labor cost about 50%. The total net loss for all 2019 was approximately 74,000, but that loss already take into a consideration of max support from New York chapter. Move to the next slide, please, Gary. Well, next slide is our comparison 2019 and 2020 budget. Obviously, there's no detail provided in this slide. However, if you're interested, email to me. I'll be happy to provide more detail. Due to COVID-19, we have substantially decreased our 2020 budget to account for the expected income reduction. And we have attempted to mitigate the impact of income reduction by controlling our expenses. And the good news is after we approve the budget, like Gary mentioned, we have insurance reduction of the cost about 3,000. Also, we have selected the external auditor to perform our audit fees has reduced almost like 8,000. So we expect our budget, hopefully 2020 will be not only 159, dollars could be more than 10,000 for sure. I think this is end of my presentation, and thank you, and I hope you are all staying safe and healthy. And now I would like to hand it over to our social dance VP, Mr. Leland Whitney. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Spencer. I am Leland Whitney, the social vice president. Our mission is to improve the quality and quantity of dance in the United States. The 145 certified USA dance chapters each are unique. The chapter members, volunteers, and boards each have their own reasons for participating and contributing that include personal health, love for dancing, socialization, desire to contribute to the well-being of their communities, and so on. The all-volunteer USA Dance National Board of Directors strive to respect and support all participants in an even-handed, but not heavy-handed manner. We strive to offer all participants the support they uniquely need to play their part successfully and joyfully. Part of my job is to support the chapter activities that will help them be successful. Over the last decade, membership declined by more than half, and chapter count is down by 25. You can see on the chart that between 2012 and 2017, we lost 21 chapters. Since 2017, we've lost an additional 4 chapters, but bear in mind, the chapters have routinely been dissolved throughout our history, but at the same time, new chapters have formed to take their place. As you see in the chart, 2 new chapters were certified since June of last year, Sierra Vista and Charlotte Harbor. And not included in the list of 145 certified chapters are 2 currently forming chapters, one in St. George, Utah, and another in Englewood, Florida. Bear in mind also that members have routinely left, but again, at the same time, new members have joined to take their place. Due to the decline, some national services to our members have been eliminated or reduced, but this cannot be an excuse to give up on our mission. USA Dance must continue to seek new members, foster new chapters, and continue to effectively support our existing chapters. Some of the support we've been providing has been to fully sponsor our Chapter and Volunteer of the Year Awards. This last year, we had 6 chapters nominated. We had 11 volunteers nominated. All of our district and national awardees received plaques. National Chapters of the Year awardees received $1,000, and our National Volunteer of the Year awardee received $250. We would have announced these winners at the national championships this year, but of course we couldn't. So I'm going to make those announcements here to honor our volunteers. The USA Dance 2019 Volunteer of the Year is awarded to Rebecca Kelly Fournier. Rebecca is a member of Chapter 6010 Tallahassee, Florida. Chapter 6010 is led by Chapter President Lolita Bronner and supported by District Number 9 Director Don Davenport. Our USA Dance 2019 Chapter of the Year is awarded to Chapter 6016 Royal Palm, Florida. Chapter 6016 led by Chapter President Connie Barnhart Coons and supported by District Number 9 Director Don Davenport. The USA Dance 2019 National Flash Mob winning chapter is 5056 Central Oklahoma, President Steve Hamilton, is supported by District Number 7 Director Diane Montgomery. We are also trying to focus on our National Ballroom Dance Week. It was successful in 2019, but given the current situation, we have not been able to move forward. It's unclear that we'll be able to do so at all this year. We are forming stronger bonds between our USA Dance professionals and Dance Sport members and our chapters and members. For example, the travel stipends to world championships are tied to chapter demos or similar activity. Professional presentations have been provided free, face-to-face, for chapter workshops, including inspirational conversations about USA Dance and dance in general. Many of our chapter reporting activities are now available to be submitted online, making life easier for our chapter leaders. Also, we are trying to address the COVID problem with video training for chapters and members, and some videos are being made and available on our Stuck at Home videos on Social Link. The dance sport side of USA Dance must be rigidly controlled ultimately because of international rules, but the social side must be treated with far less rigid set of controls, although certain aspects must stringently be enforced as they deal with nonprofit status, IRS filings, insurance, music licensing, safe sport, annual reporting, legal issues, and so on. But for the most part, I strongly feel each chapter should be allowed to follow its own path to what they define as success, and of course, while being subject to the current public health restrictions. How do we seek new members and grow our chapter count? The annual chapter reports filed and recently analyzed for data covering the last several years partially answer that question. Next slide, please, Gary. The chapters that are drawing and spitting off new chapters are doing many things more aggressively than other chapters. Other than remembering to ask non-member participants to join USA Dance, the two top things your chapter may want to try when feasible due to the public health restrictions would be to offer more events in the community that go beyond the monthly dances and the associated lessons. Also, seek nearby locations to initiate satellite dance programs. These are the things our larger, more successful chapters and districts are doing. We also must continue our chapter leadership training. We need to continue updating our document library to make it more user-friendly, especially using video training. Far easier to look at a YouTube video. And that process is underway. We need to continue focusing on best practices and lessons learned. We need to encourage more participation in National Ballroom Dance Week, Volunteer of the Year Award, and Chapter of the Year Award. We need to continue the enhancements to the program with the monetary awards. continue the awards going out to the winners, continue supporting the Flash Mob when once we get through the pandemic, and encourage each chapter and each district to identify a 2020, if we can do it this year, award winner. And then we need to encourage each district to identify a 2020 winner from all of the chapters in their district. We need to continue to strengthen the bonds between social, dance board, and professional members. We need to keep all our district positions, district director positions, filled as they are. We have provided funding for district meetings for this year. We need to encourage our organizers to hold a social dance of all USA dance competitions. We continue to encourage that. And we need to develop a long-term plan to reinstate the National Chapter Leadership Conference via online video conferencing. We can't afford to have face-to-face conference anymore at a national level and really at a district level. Again, our mission is to improve the quality and the quantity of dance in the United States. This will be achieved if we all work together while celebrating how unique each of us are. Thank you for listening. I'd like to pass this on to our dance board group with Michael Murphy.
Thank you, Leland. Hello, everyone. My name is Michael Murphy. I'm one of the dance board delegates. I'm filling in for Giacomo Stapaglia here. So you've heard that our mission is to expand the quality and quantity of dance in the United States. And on the dance sports side of that, what we've done is we've looked at expanding the number of competitions, so expanding the opportunities for members to compete, and increasing the quality of competition. And that's been expanding opportunities for members to train. We've also focused on promoting interaction between athletes and the community. And that includes where athletes have to give demonstrations or free workshops to the chapters, or they provide similar services to nonprofit entities within the community, such as local schools. Can I have the next slide, please? This is the Dance Board Council. So our role is to advise the board of directors on dance board issues. We also facilitate, regulate, and sanction competitions, and we oversee athletes and the issues related to athletes. The members of the Dance Board Council are Giacomo Stacaglia, the Dance Board VP, Roger Greenwald, who's a Dance Board Delegate, Ina Breer, Dance Board Delegate, Damon Pataluna, Dance Board Delegate, myself, also a Dance Board Delegate. We're all elected positions. Then we have Jan Vasquez. She's the chair of the senior committee. And then Elise Griffiths and Andrew Morena, they are co-chairs of the gender neutral committee. These are all the voting members of the Dance Board Council. Elise and Andrew share a single vote. We do need to revamp or regenerize our junior athlete committee. And so we will be looking for people with that. And the chair of that, after they've been on the Dance Board Council for a while, will receive a vote. Can we have the next slide, please? So here's the competitive achievements from 2017, when Giacomo came in, through to the present. So USA Dance has increased the number of competitions, so again, increasing opportunities for its members to compete to dance, with new events in the Western US and in Florida. USA Dance held its first WDSF World Championship in the smooth style that was held earlier this year in Atlanta. USA Dance established a national team training camp program. We established a ranking point system for championship competitions and competitors. We've merged senior four and senior five events with nationals. Previously, they were held separately. We established the professional competitor class and pro-am competitor class. And then USA Dance has also increased integration of elite athletes with chapters and the local community through that performance workshop requirement for world representatives to receive their travel stipend. And both Gary and Leland have mentioned that. And I've been very happy to see that happen. And I've heard good things from both the chapters that received the free workshops and from the athletes who've given them. Can we have the next slide, please? Here is a graphic showing the change in competitions from 2012 through 2019. These are NQEs and sanctioned competitions. And what you can see here is that there was a significant reduction from 13 NQEs in 2012 down to a low of 9. In 2015 and 2016. Again, these are NQEs and sanctioned, and then increasing up to 14 NQEs and sanctioned competitions in 2019. So over a period of the last three, 4 years, we've managed to completely reverse the decrease. Unfortunately, COVID is creating a significant problem for 2020. Can we have the next slide, please? Okay, we can go to the next one. This is simply a listing of all the competitions for those who want to see the points. Next slide, please. Okay, so Nationals 2020 and 2021. This is, of course, a significant issue. As our athletes know, we had to cancel the Nationals that were scheduled for March in Utah because of COVID-19. And those are currently rescheduled to occur at three NQEs in October. The Carolina Fall Classic, which will host preteen through youth. The American Dance Sport Festival, which will host under 21 adult, senior one, and collegiate title events. And the Chicago Dance Sport Challenge, which will host the senior 2 through 5 events. A significant issue is whether or not this will be permitted to go forward, because all these events are subject, of course, to social distancing and other restrictions on group and community events. We will make it a final announcement about the individual competitions 6 to 8 weeks before they're scheduled to happen. So that means in August, beginning of August, we'll start making official notices, providing official notices as to whether or not we believe these competitions will be able to occur given the local state restrictions and requirements and local county and other jurisdiction requirements. 2021 Nationals, that's scheduled for April 16th through 18th in Atlanta, Georgia. It's the same venues where the 2020 World Smooth Championships were held. The adjudicators are selected by the national organization. However, the event will be hosted by Crowder Dance Sport. As Gary had mentioned in his presentation, this has helped us to reduce the outlay of expenses, and it will still have what we believe will be a high quality national championship. So hopefully 2021 will happen and go forward well. Again, that'll be subject to COVID-19 and other social distancing restrictions as next year comes throughout. Can we have the next slide, please? Okay, these were the dance board goals that were presented at the November 2019 face-to-face meeting. Some of these are not going to happen. They are being postponed. Some are still happening. So these were presented by Giacomo, and they were to incorporate additional disciplines into competitions, break and Special Olympics, adaptive dance sport. You've heard Greg speak about some of these already. So the goal is still to incorporate these in. Obviously, that'll have to wait until 2021. Or potentially later, to expand the ranking point system to all open competitions, pro-am competitions, and syllabus competitions. We're working on the infrastructure to do that, which would be an automated ranking system, to establish additional competitions in the Northeast region. We've been in discussions with some people about that, potential organizers, but again, that is likely to hold or be held till 2021. To create regional and style-based circuits, again, that'll have to wait until we have our competitions back on. And to create a competitive circuit with the Canadian Federation. And then our other goal for 2020 was to increase dance sport membership by 5% from 2019 membership. That will probably have to, again, be postponed to 2021. Can we have the next slide, please? Here are the revised dance sport goals for 2020 from the Dance Sport Council. And that is to work with organizers and athletes to develop appropriate practices for holding competitions post COVID-19. We have met with the organizers of the upcoming competitions this year, which are the Kansas City Dance Challenge, the Carolina Fall Classic, the American Dance Sport Festival, and the Chicago Dance Challenge. And we should be coming out with our guidelines for these competitions within the next 2 weeks. So people have an idea of what's expected in terms of how they should behave at these competitions and how they will be run. Again, a primary aspect of this is to maintain the safety of the athletes, the adjudicators, everybody there, the officials. It is very important that we not have a competition become a spreading event. That would be very bad both for USA Dance and for dance sport in general, for ballroom dancing in general. We've also invited professionals to prepare short videos of approved syllabus patterns for solo proficiency events. This is being handled largely by the Collegiate Committee, is taking the laboring oar on this. We're currently revising the rule book to improve readability, remove inconsistencies, and to facilitate competition, and essentially to make it easier for both athletes, organizers, and everyone else to read and understand, and to make it easier to host competitions. and we're working to automate the ranking point system. Currently, it's done by a combination of automation and manually. And if we can fully automate it, then we can expand it, and that'll help with creating rankings that can then be used to track where people are as they go forward. Many athletes like to see a ranking system. They like to track how they compare against their competitors on that sort of ranking system. And I believe that is all. So I'd like to now hand it over to Melissa Dexter, the VP of Professional.
Thank you, Michael. I hope everyone, good afternoon, and I hope everyone is well. And mainly, I hope you're all keeping up your dancing somehow. If you're dancing in your living room, in your garage, outside in your garden, solo, it's just important for everyone to keep up their dancing. So as you see here, here's the USA Dance Professional Organizational Chart. Again, I'm Melissa Dexter, the VP. On our Professional Council voting members, we have Mr. Mark Barth, Mr. Nicholas Cotton, Mr. Wayne Crowder, and Ms. Kim Smith. And you can also see down below our non-voting chairs of some of our committees. Some of them do have a chair, some have not been filled yet. As said by in other presentations, we are always looking for volunteers. So if anyone is interested in any of these positions, please contact me. We would love to have a discussion about that because we would love to fill these positions. Next slide, please, Gary. Here are some of the Professional Council's projects for 2020, and some will definitely be beyond due to the current situation. So the professional communication, the Professional Council is developing methods by which to reach out and communicate right now with the chapters and social members. And as Leland has talked about, we have developed some videos that are now on the YM forum, Stuck at Home. Again, any other professionals that wish to volunteer to do a quick little video, please contact me so we can get more videos up there for our chapters and social members. We also have communication with the USA Dance members and non-members to promote National Ballroom Dance Week. This has been done, as you've heard, with the flash mob since 2017. This is so great. My goal is that one day soon in the next 5 years, every chapter or more than 50% of our chapters are all out in our community promoting dancing, whatever level, for all ages. This is definitely a dream of mine. And then with USA professionals and how they can help and build our organization. As you all know, the professionals have just been in USA Dance for a few years. So we really do need help in building this part of the pie for USA Dance. We work with our competition organizers and the Canadian counterpart to build North America competition circuit. We have adjudicator education. We're organizing an American Smooth and Rhythm Congress, emphasizing the different skills needed to judge them both effectively. And we are wanting to build the Pro-Am to continue this program as a vital part of our organization benefiting both amateurs and the professionals. Next slide. Here we have our examination council report. So as you can see in the past year, we have three new adjudicators, candidates in the process. We reactivated three officials, reactivated one adjudicator. We have one new invigilator, two new scrutineers, four new WDSF adjudicators. We have a WDSF upgrade and one in the process. We have had two WDSF technical exams given and three USA Dance conversion exams given. We have all active adjudicators have met the safe sport and background check requirements. Adjudicator letter and the WDSF applications have been placed on the Professional Council page of USA Dance website for easier access. We have the WDSF Congress, which was held January 29th and 30th in Atlanta, Georgia. We had six participants in the chair Congress, attendees all from the United States. The Adjudicator Congress had 28 attendees from the US, Canada, and Armenia. Testing material outlining procedures and exams have been created for USA Dance conversion exams for American Smooth, Rhythm, Standard, and Latin. The Invigilator exam has been written for those adjudicators wishing to become invigilators. An examination department document library has been created and maintained to secure a permanent place for all our adjudication exams, adjudication exam results, and requirements passed. And this is a major step forward and so important in establishing a continuity between administrations when there's a change. This is just so vital. And this is just fabulous. We're excited about that. Next slide, please, Gary. We also have been working hard, and this is from the organizers committee. Some of the accomplishments that we've had, many organizers completed a survey sent to update their competition details, contact information, address any concerns or requests, suggestions to help improve their events. There's been two conference calls with multiple organizers, one in November 2019 and one in March of 2020. A delegate from the Gender Neutral Committee joined the March 2020 call to answer organizers' concerns and questions. Addressed and resolved concerns with the advertising of USA Dance competition through email and the USA Dance website, formulating in conjunction with the PC and the DSC recommendations for existing and new events to retain or acquire NQ status. And then our goals is to work closely with the organizers to help them integrate the gender neutral events into their competition and other logistical needs, clarification and replacement of ambiguous wording within the rules affecting competitions, formation of a pamphlet promoting the organizing of USA Dance competitions and recommendations on how to organize a successful event. And we finalized in conjunction with the Professional Council and the Dance Sport Council requirements for existing the new events to retain or acquire NQE status. So ladies and gentlemen, this is the Professional Accounts report for this annual general meeting. Again, I hope you are all safe and well. And like I said, everyone just keep dancing. And at this time, I would like to turn it back over to Gary for the presentation of the collegiate. Thank you.
Thanks, Melissa. I'm sorry, Ross Pierce was unable to attend today. So he has requested that I present in his place. So the Collegiate Network has been working very diligently over the past few years and in the last year as well on developing and building the college network within USA Dance. And for 2020-2021, our goals, obviously given the situation of COVID, some of these are being pushed back but into 2021, but they are working towards increasing their marketing and exposure for the 2021 National Collegiate Dance Sport Championships. That's the NCDC. And just so if you're not aware, when we had the first one championships, which actually was very successful, the second one when we held that one, that was a 25% increase in attendees. Obviously this year it had to be canceled. So we are looking for, again, a substantial increase next year as well. So they are developing in the process of developing plans for the NCDC in 2022 and what that's going to look like. Obviously trying to expand the space because we are outgrowing the space that we have there. And then also looking towards adding additional colleges from across the country. Working towards introducing a point system for collegiate competitors. It's something the collegiate competitors have expressed a desire for and a need for. And so we are working towards satisfying that particular request. And that I think will help us with building relationships with the collegiate teams across the colleges and across the country. We're also developing some best practices for college clubs and teams so that they can implement those and build the depth and level quality of their teams. And so that is something that, again, these clubs are needing and wanting and asking us for. We're trying to assemble contacts for colleges and their coaches. And so we're looking at expanding our reach. And so if individuals do have colleges or contacts for colleges and their coaches that are not participating in the NCDC events or other USA Dance events, please reach out to Ross and provide him with that information. That would be greatly appreciated. And we're looking at increasing our collegiate memberships. That is something we need to continue to work on and continue to build, so that can help us, again, continue our building of the organization and the relationships between our collegiate and our dance board members, as well as our collegiate members and our social and professional members as well. So we're going to begin working over the course of next year with the breaking committee to build college participation. Many of the college dancers are in college or in that age range. So we're really looking at what we can do to build that out. And then we're also developing a digitized donation system for collecting donations for the collegiate activities. And so, and of course, once that's developed, we would probably look at, or we would look at expanding that into other areas of the organization as well. In terms of accomplishments, the NCDC 2021 is planned to be in Chicago again this year, March 27th to 28th. And I'm sorry, I should have said in 2021, this coming year. there was no financial loss from canceling NCDC in 2020. And that should have also been expressed with respect to nationals this year as well. There was no financial loss for canceling that. We have a larger social media presence, and new college teams are showing interest as a response to that. And so that is very helpful as well. We have a media team in the college network group that's working in those types of communications, and it is having a positive impact. Volunteers, again, have been working on the point system I mentioned earlier, but that has been delayed in part due to the COVID-19. And so we do expect that to roll out here later on this fall, but that is being worked on. The draft of the best practices, which again we mentioned above in terms of the goal, is under development, and that we hope to have done again later on this year. And then the team has added volunteers, a number of volunteers working within the college network, as we've added volunteers in other areas of the organization. So that is a positive outcome that we've had over. In this area is that these volunteers are adding a lot of value to this part of the organization. So that's great. As far as obstacles, we really do need to find some additional volunteers who would be willing to reach out to the colleges and to help build the college network. So if that is something that you are interested in and would like to participate in, it is something that we certainly would love to have you work on with the collegiate network, Ross and the team, and that would be, you know, positive for our collegiate members. With that, that is what we want. What communicating for the collegiate network, and I will hand this off to our membership director, Mr. Herb McGurk. Herb.
Thank you, Gary. Thank you very much. I have to unmute myself. And thank you for putting this presentation together. Thank you for all the presenters, and thank you for all the members that are attending and have interest in understanding the interworks of USA Dance. I am the membership director. My name is Herb McGurk. I'm also the chair of the ethics committee. I'm the webmaster, district director number 6, and president of the Los Angeles chapter. No, I don't make extra money, okay? I make the same as any president of a social chapter or any chapter in USA Dance. That being said, I wanted to introduce myself and then our team, which is Tom Weaver. He's the president of Massachusetts. I believe he's still there as the president. Membership reporting. We have Tally Association Management, which is processing all the dues and also answering any questions you might have if you can't renew if there's some reason. The same 800 number we had before of the central office now goes to them. I do apologize, you may be getting a answering machine, but the person at the other end will return your call and solve your problem. Royco is a mailing service that we use. Basically, I know a number of people get internet announcements stating that their membership is up. We also do to mailings as well, just as an extra notice, not to upset you or overwhelm you with information, but we do love the fact that you renew and support USA Dance. Membership program that we use is your membership. This is the database management system that we use. And again, the store is Gene Cupra. I believe that is still working. If it's not, let me know. And but I'm sure she's done a wonderful job of continually giving out pins and license plates, covers, which I bought a few of and given them away. And I believe she's still doing that and has participated in that. Gary, let's have the next slide, please. Okay, the membership responsibilities are that we process all the membership payments, the store ordering processing, membership database reporting and maintenance, maintaining to make sure that all the memberships, sometimes people will sign up twice. Like, I'm not quite sure, I haven't signed up for the last couple of years, so I'm gonna sign up again as a new member, but we will put you back into that same old membership number and sort of maintaining this database as well. Chapter management, bulk mailings, membership notices, which you'll get, and the membership promotions, incentives, and communications, which we're now gonna be working with the communication department. And again, we are the administrator of Social Link, which actually I've sent guides out to every single member, but I believe I need to send that out again because we now have a private Facebook page. It's called Your Membership, or actually it's called Social Link. And there is a web-based program as well as a mobile program. I just got off the phone this morning and trained the Charlotte Harbor, Florida chapter, number 2126, and trained 3 of their administrators on the Social Link aspects, also the web-based access and what we call is a web-based website on the USA Dance website so that anybody can go to the USA Dance website and find any chapter they want and find out what's going on. Also, the membership responsibilities website maintenance for the moment. Next page, please. So here are our challenges, communicating with the chapters and membership. This is, I think in the beginning in 2017, when I got here, it's the first time I've ever been on the national board before, board of directors. I certainly started communicating, sending out emails, tell us how we can help you. I'm still of that opinion. I'm just a little bit inundated with a number of other things that I'm doing, but I certainly encourage any member or any chapter to contact the membership director and tell us what you think we can improve, how we can communicate with you better, And if you're not getting communications, how we can improve that. Challenges with using and maintaining YM logins and the inflexibility of it. That is a challenge. Sometimes people, for example, I have one member who has the same email for he and his wife, and he signs up immediately with himself, but he can't using the same email and changing the password. So there are some challenges in regards to YM. We do have the 800 number of the central office that will help you in any way you possibly need. If you aren't able to renew your membership, we certainly encourage you to do so and appreciate your support. Providing value to members when they join. We do say thank you very much for joining and thank you for being part of USA Dance, but this is always a challenge to be able to really feel like you're welcomed. We do appreciate you supporting USA Dance, and this because it is a membership organization, and everything that we do is basically trying to improve membership, trying to provide the information that you need so that you can find value in your membership. So again, this is what we're working towards, but it is a challenge. Driving continuous membership engagement. We created the social link. I actually became membership director because I wanted to be able to have a membership card on the phone. Social link accomplishes that. There's a mobile app for Social Link. You can go to any of your Android or iPhones and go to Social Link mobile app, download it using the same sign in you have in signing it up with USA Dance. And there's a mobile app there. Go to the quick links. It says membership card. You can hit that and we'll give you your membership card on your phone. That was one reason that I wanted to really become membership director, was to provide that convenience to everything. The community data lives outside of USA Dance. Yes, I think there's a lot of information that lives outside, and that's the chapters providing newsletters and information about themselves. That's a challenge. I mean, the reason why we sort of have tried to bring in the chapter programs so that all the chapters are under USA Dance is to be able to centralize all the information that's going on in the 145 different chapters around the country. That's quite a number of different chapters, and there's probably a lot of different things happening in every community. Some people are doing dances, some people are not doing dances. So we're trying to centralize that by having all the chapters under one roof, under one umbrella, so that you can not only find out what's going on in national, but also find out what's going on in every chapter. Getting chapters to promote membership, that's a challenge, of course. And I am continually addressing this as now the president of the Los Angeles chapter. We have one person at their door that makes sure they ask everybody if they'd like to be a member. And unfortunately, we haven't been able to open up this year. But I certainly encourage a membership director or a membership board member to get people to be part of USA Dance. We're a nonprofit organization. Everybody works as a volunteer. And for $35, $45 or $70 a year, I think I just thank you for supporting us and hope that we can have more members, if for anything, to keep USA Dance alive, well, and healthy. Giving chapters avenues to increase revenue, advertising, fundraising events. This is a challenge, I think, because it's just, I think it's possible now that we are sort of settling into a new sort of format in regards to our website to be able to advertise, to be able to have fundraisers. You can actually, in the new program, Social Link, with your chapter website, have use PayPal there. There's ways of collecting monies before dances, fundraisers. And certainly encourage you to do anything you possibly can in your community to raise funds for USA Dance through programs that will benefit the community. And I think now that we have a marketing committee, we can come out with perhaps more ways of and avenues that we can use. Recovering the 50% loss in membership over the last 7 years has been my biggest challenge. I think it's really important that we continue. I will continue to address you, communicate with you, and provide you the support that we can give you. So please, I do encourage you at any time, if you have some ideas or you have some questions, please contact me at membership-dir@usadance.org. Thank you. Next slide, please. So here are the membership benefits, connecting to peers and colleagues through SocialLink. You can do that. I will send out after this meeting, again, to every single member, a guide to how to use SocialLink, because it is a really great engagement program that we can have to be able to connect with members. If you have any questions, again, please send me an email. Connecting to content and education is some of the benefits that we have here, because of the many different programs that the different departments have in regards to providing education and content. Connecting to dance events is really a great benefit. You can find out what's going on in any chapter in all over the country by doing that. Member-centric experience is our goal. Discounts to USA Dance studios and dances, this is something that it's there when we get back on the floor. Discounts to goods and services is also there. We have that on the website if you ever want to get any discounts to, I believe, department stores or travel, as well as office supplies. SocialLink membership engagement. Again, I'm going to keep pushing for that, and I will be sending out an email on how to use SocialLink and what a benefit it can be. Again, we have our own private Facebook page. You have every single member has their own profile, and they can add their own pictures and pages, whatever they want to do. It's kind of a lot of fun. I know it's going to be a while for us to really get on board with all of it, because we are all have so many applications in our life that it's hard to just work with one or two or three or a dozen of them at the same time. But I do encourage it, because it's a way of us engaging with each other. Next slide, please. Our achievements is in regards to membership achievements since 2017 is that our new national website, which we've created, we integrate the front end of the national website with membership system, which is YM, so that all the chapters can find out who their members are, who their past members were, and be able to create their own website and own their own landing page. All the chapters events appear on the national website, the social media element of the national website, therefore all the members can log into the national website and talk to each other. We have gone mobile, so I do encourage that. You can go to SocialLink mobile app either on either your phones, and you should be able to download that. We have a chapters forums, which allows people to be able to, each chapter has the ability to create their own forum or blog, and every member can participate and find out what's going there. Every member has their own profile page, and you can also have dance registrations and even have prepays if you like. So these are just some of the achievements in regards to the membership page and the membership department. I believe that, we have one last slide, Gary, please. All right. I was asked to give you what our membership looked like since 2005. I don't know who had all these records, but there were records going back to 2005. I'm sure there are records that go back even farther than that. But when I joined in about 2007, and at that time we had about 22,000 members. That has steadied off till 2011 and 12. And then there was a sharp decrease from 2012 to 2014. When I came on board, we were still going down. By 2017, I'm trying to, as they say, not lower the curve, but make a bend in the decrease. And we're kind of slowly a leveling out. So level the curve is what we're trying to do here. We're at about, I think about 7,500 members. That's quite a decrease from the past, but we really need to look towards the future and support each other as we go forward. And I do, again, ask that you contact me if you have any suggestions on how that we might accomplish that. I do appreciate your time and listening to my presentation, and thank you so much, Gary, for running this through. I'm going to turn it now over to our Senior Vice President, Greg Warner.
Thanks, Herb. For the next 5 minutes or so, we are done in at the half hour. I'm going to comment or respond to some of the questions that were sent in. As you recall, we did ask members to send in questions so that we could be prepared to respond to those. I'm going to respond to as many as time permits now, but all of these questions and the answers will be posted in SocialLink either later today or tomorrow. So bear with me for a minute. The first question I'd like to address is what is specifically being done to revive American Dancer in either print or electronically after the one edition was released? And we all miss American Dancer. Angela Prince did a wonderful job producing a magazine and mailing out to all the members and public libraries around the country. But as you may recall, this just became unaffordable for us. Angela did a great job. She was paid for that, as she should have been. But since we don't have the monies to address that, we're seeking volunteers. And we have made a couple of call for volunteers. As is mentioned in the question, we were able to do one electronic magazine, but that volunteer just was overwhelmed and with other issues couldn't continue. And despite a couple of continued requests for volunteers, we didn't have any responses. But if there are people out there that have publishing, editorial, graphic design, or other kinds of experiences, let us know. We would be happy to get you in touch with our new marketing communications committee. They have some ideas for addressing this major missing feature of USA Dance. And they're working on a plan for that. It'll be a while in the making, but we are, this hasn't fallen off our radar. It's very important to us as an organization, as members of the organization, and we do want to address this need. Why aren't emails sent from the national office with various messages, updates, and policies also posted on website and posted in SocialLink? I think we acknowledge this. It's been noted a couple times during our presentations that we haven't been doing a good job with this. I'm not going to make up any excuses for it. We just haven't been. We are going to improve this. I think we will post most messages that deal with membership to SocialLink. I think SocialLink, as Herb expresses, for our members, and most of the messages will be posted there. But we will respond to this in a very rapid manner. And another question I think that was answered during the presentations, the cost per month of the new association management company compared to the salaries. I'm not going to comment any further on that because I think that I addressed that in the presentation. There are some other questions here that has to deal with some of the social activities. I think Leland addressed those quite well in his presentation. I would just add the reinstatement of the national leadership face-to-face meeting or any meeting that way is a high priority for all of us here at USA Dance. Having been able to attend a couple of those chapter leadership conferences in the past when they're held, it energizes our members, the leadership in this organization, allows them to get networked with other leadership, to meet the national organization and leaders, and we really understand the importance of this, and it is a high priority for us. And if we had the money, we would do face-to-face immediately. And Gary, we have 2 minutes left by my clock. I don't know if you wanted to make any final comments before we adjourn at half past the hour.
Sure, I can make a couple. All right, thank you, Greg. I just want to say that we are going to post this presentation, which has been recorded today, on SocialLink, along with the presentation itself. I also wanted, there was a request. I see there were a couple of requests regarding our requests on participants. By my count, Just today, the audience members, we had 76 people viewing the presentation today. So I want to thank everyone who was able to take the time and to do that. I will also say that I do want to thank you, the individuals that are on the call and the board members and so on for continuing to be members of USA Dance and continue to participate in the organization and continue to be a volunteer and work towards building the organization and making it better. And if anyone's interested in helping out on a national level, I mean, we would certainly be interested in talking with you, and you could talk, you could contact anyone on the board regarding that. So the other thing that I just did want to say is that as an organization, we really know that there's been some concern around the directions that we've been taking and the changes that we've been making, but the board really feels that some of these changes, specifically broadening our scope and looking at restructuring are going to be we all believe strongly that they're going to be beneficial and have already demonstrated some beneficial effects for the organization, whether that has to do with cost, whether it has to do with functionality, whether it has to do with just the effectiveness. You may not be seeing it necessarily. Again, as I said earlier, we haven't been very effective in our communications. I really hope that and believe that will change over the course of the next couple of months. But in other areas of the organization, functionally, I think we have made significant improvements, and those will continue to reap benefits over the upcoming years. But let me just thank everyone for attending, and unless someone else on the panel had something to say, I think we have run out of time, we look forward to continue to work for the members. And again, any suggestions, comments, please send them to the members' voice at usadance.org. We will respond to them, and we will get back to you, and we will post those questions as well as part of the AGM process. So we will post them also in social links. So thank you all, and have a wonderful weekend. And we will hopefully talk soon.